I have an older brother,
and I don't have any younger siblings.
And I feel like I'm the more curious and empathetic one. And I'm confident it's because my parents kind of drove that curiosity. And when they saw me picking up books as like a 2-year-old or 3-year-old, they're like, here, just keep reading. Obviously, there's no internet back then. Just keep reading. And they kept giving me books, and they're like, yeah, you're 3 reading the encyclopedia. We don't know if you understood what you were reading, but like you were sitting there flipping the pages for like hours, so we assumed you were enjoying it for some reason. So I feel like my curiosity and empathy came very, very, very early, but that it was my parents that kind of pushed that along a little bit.
I can certainly see that. My parents were very supportive of me exploring a variety of things. But one other thing came to mind while you were saying that. I also spent time in my career working with Acumen Fund, and while I was there, I met Jocelyn Wyatt, who is part of Ideo, and they have created the concept of human-centered design. And through interacting with her and learning about, you know, the way that they approached design philosophies, and I'm certain that influenced my mindset as well.
Bryan Farris is the president of Goldfish Code, a US-based company that helps companies use motivation to figure out exactly how to design the best application for their customers. So in this conversation, we talked about motivation, like the motivation of why he's doing this business, the motivation behind the process that they come up with to figure out how to design the best things for these end users, motivation for travel and other things that we like to do with our lives. What is his morning routine like, and how he stays motivated for doing the work that he does, and much more. So this is episode number 201. We have been doing this for almost 4 years now, and we're just getting started. So let's get to it. Your business is centered around motivation, and motivation is something that psychologists are extremely interested in. I think it's a fascinating topic, and I'm really glad that we're going to talk about it. And so I'm curious to know, what motivates you to be curious about motivation?
That's a really great meta question. Honestly, for me, I'm very empathetic person. I've always got the very high scores on empathy in Myers-Briggs and stuff like that. And so just throughout my life, I've put myself in others' shoes and thought, okay, you know, what is actually driving their action? What is the root cause behind, you know, their perspective on a particular challenge or situation? And that constant mindset of putting myself in other people's shoes led to this, you know, more, you know, traditional framework for how we approach designing products for users by putting ourselves in their mindset and looking at what will actually motivate them to do the things we want them to do.
Is there something that happened in your life, or is there something that your parents did that guided you towards that curiosity?
Well, it might be that I'm the oldest of 5 kids. And so when I was younger, I had to deal with a bunch of smaller children that were looking up to me and, you know, kind of followed me. But I also had to be a role model and think about, you know, their perspective on things. And my parents were very values-based. So I think being in that kind of life position certainly affected my outlook.
I find that interesting because I have an older brother, and I don't have any younger siblings. And I feel like I'm the more curious and empathetic one.
Yeah.
And I'm confident it's because my parents kind of drove that curiosity. And when they saw me picking up books as like a 2-year-old or 3-year-old, they're like, here, just keep reading. Obviously, there's no internet back then. Just keep reading. And they kept giving me books, and they're like, yeah, you're 3 reading the encyclopedia. We don't know if you understood what you were reading, but like you were sitting there flipping the pages for like hours. So we assumed you were enjoying it for some reason. So I feel like my curiosity and empathy came very, very, very early, but that it was my parents that kind of pushed that along a little bit.
Very interesting. Yeah, I can certainly see that. My parents were very supportive with me exploring a variety of things. One other thing came to mind while you were saying that. I also spent time in my career working with Acumen Fund. And while I was there, I met Jocelyn Wyatt, who is part of Ideo, and they have created the concept of human-centered design. And through interacting with her and learning about, you know, the way that they approached design philosophies, And I'm certain that that influenced my mindset as well.
I've had multiple opportunities to think about motivation and human-centered design through the different companies that I've worked for or owned. And yet I still have never felt like my ideas are right, or that I wonder or worry that they're not doing what I want people to do, or that they're not enjoying it the way I'm hoping they'll enjoy it. Do you go through that within your own design process? And if so, how do you minimize that fear that you're doing it wrong?
I'm sure, you know, everyone throughout, you know, anything that you do, there's elements of self-doubt. But what motivates me to kind of keep going and feel confidence that, you know, what we're doing is right is really one, through results that we've seen, but two, through, you know, studying a lot of other frameworks and everything that I've created on the motivation driven design side of things is rooted in, you know, research that came out of behavioral psychology or that came out of other UX design initiatives. And I've read dozens of books on the topic. And as a result, I feel like the conclusions I've drawn from all of those are rooted in a lot of expert research that gives me confidence that it's at least in the right direction. Now, the trick is applying all of that philosophy to a particular product and thinking about how that, you know, product can leverage those same kinds of concepts. And all, you know, because all of this work is dealing with humans and how humans are going to react, it is impossible to be 100% certain that a particular feature or function will achieve the goals. But that's where post-implementation, we have measurement in place to ensure that, you know, we're tracking metrics and measuring what is successful and what's not, and, you know, using that data-driven approach to guide future improvements. So there is an element of take your you know, experience and leverage that to make, you know, what you believe is the best decision. And then at the end of the day, it's a data-driven experiment. So that initial experience is just the hypothesis. But once you go ahead and implement it, the process becomes more data driven, and therefore you can have confidence in what you've done.
What kinds of things do you think about when you're planning a user's journey, for example? I know you said that you look at other texts and research and things like that, but when you put those things aside, there's still work that has to get done. And I'm sure over all these years, you've developed some sort of a process. And I'm not sure if it's the same process for each product, which then may lend itself to kind of groupthink, where the result is the same across most of the products, or whether you try to keep things fresh for each client based on different inputs. So I'm really curious about that.
Absolutely. So we do have a process, and it is the same process, but it doesn't result in the groupthink that you're talking about, because pretty early on, things start to go down a unique path. And by that, I mean, we start with the strategy, and we start primarily with the business strategy. So what we're looking for is to talk with the business owner or the stakeholder and understand what are the key business metrics that they are trying to move the needle on with this particular product or feature. And how does that fit in the broader context of their business ecosystem and, you know, bigger strategy? And so based off of that, it really points the direction in terms of where our focus should be and what we're trying to achieve. And then what we do is we look at the specific product or application and look at, you know, what are the actual actions that we want the users to take in that application that will inevitably lead towards those business goals. So usually there's, you know, a handful of business goals that are top of mind for the stakeholders involved. And then each of those goals can be achieved through, you know, several different user actions or user actions that lead to other actions that inevitably lead to those goals. And so once we have an understanding of the actions that we want to motivate, then we get into looking at motivation techniques. And so at that point, we're able to, you know, break down, okay, here's the types of actions, here's different techniques we can use to encourage those actions. And then we actually go through a user persona exercise, similar to what marketing companies do when they're talking about how do we market a product to different kinds of user personas, and how, you know, how does the customer base break down into different categories, and what does each of those categories care about, and how do we make our marketing pitch, you know, meet the need of a particular user persona. We take that same kind of approach and break down the user base of a product, and try to understand, you know, how do those people behave, what do they care about, and then how can we make sure that we apply motivation techniques that will motivate each of the different types of user personas to do the actions that we had talked about. And so that's where things start to become much more innovative, because once you have these types of techniques, they are more of a guide for what motivates someone, and not they're not going to define a specific functionality for a specific application until you know, get into the weeds of that particular product and what it's about. It can become very different from product to product once you go through that process.
When you were describing the process, my thinking was, how can this be fun? How can you make design fun? And not just for the user, but for the people that are working on the deep psychological nuances of motivation to get the design the way you want it. Because describing the process is difficult to do, but designing it and making it enjoyable so that the team wants to be there day in and day out for the days, weeks, months, you know, years of work. So how do you make it fun?
It's a really great question, because actually making it fun is part of what motivates people in general. So it's, you know, that's part of the, one of the ways that we can make the actual product that we're doing more sticky for the users themselves. So we're looking at ways to make those products fun as well. But the process of going through this, it actually, the reason why it becomes fun is because of one of the elements of motivation, which is empowerment and creativity. And so when we look at motivating people, one of the elements that we're looking for is, how can we embed opportunities for people to be creative, to make choices within a product or an application? And the reason that that's very motivating for people is because most people are kind of social explorer people. We like to build things. We like to create things. And when you create something, you have this intrinsic positive feeling, and it creates this great affinity with what you're doing. And so throughout the products that we make, we try to put in opportunities for the end user to be creative and to experience that kind of positive affinity. And there's ways to do it subtly, and there's ways to do it, you know, in a bigger way. But what I've found is that the process of, you know, taking this data-driven approach of kind of like breaking out the user personas and looking analytically at each of the elements of motivation, and then determining what we might do, is that process works. But then at the end of it, we ultimately get to a point where we say, well, we think we can use this motivation technique. Let's brainstorm and be creative about how we could build a feature that meets, you know, that matches this particular application, that actually like does whatever that particular technique is. And so there's an element here that's really creative. You know, the entire motivation-driven design framework provides us this structure, but it's a structure that allows us to isolate specific things that we should brainstorm a creative new feature out of. And so once you get to that point, it gets to be very fun. We have conversations around, well, we could add this feature, and then, you know, that might like motivate these people, and you could use that to also send a notification to someone else about, you know, letting them know what's going on with that particular client. And those kinds of things get very fun when we're in that brainstorm session with a client of ours and brainstorming what could be done with their product. It gets very exciting for them.
So exciting for the client and exciting for the customer, the end user.
Yeah.
But does that ever get tedious for your team? I personally love it.
Those meetings where we're brainstorming new features, they certainly don't feel like work. It feels like a fun, creative session.
I've always enjoyed the idea of, or the process of coming up with new ideas. And it always fascinates the people I'm working with. They're like, how did you get that? Like, I was just talking to someone the other day, and she was presented with a business opportunity by a potential partner. And I just started brainstorming ideas around it. And she's like, it was just meant to be like a social thing. It wasn't even meant to be like a proper business. She's like, how did you spend like 5 seconds and turn it into a business? I was like, because that's how I think. I think about how to make something make money. So I'm attuned to that. And so I guess you're attuned to that in your own way. I guess my curiosity here is, how do you keep your team excited about it through that process, even if the customers and the end users are potentially excited about it later down the road?
Honestly, it's because my team and I show up every day. You know, we make software products, and so code is essentially our canvas, and these kinds of brainstorms is our paintbrush. And you know, we're genuinely excited about building products that are going to be impactful, and there's sort of a trust in the process, and knowing that when you go through this and build something that really takes UM or user motivation into account, that it leads to better outcomes for the end product. And you know, it being in that world, showing up each day and having the opportunity to brainstorm and be creative about, you know, what could be included in a product is very exciting for us. And I think that my entire team is motivated by that.
Do you have a morning routine that you use that gets you psyched for the day, that allows you to come with the energy that you need? Probably a nonstop energy for the hours of the day that you're working?
Yes, absolutely. My day is fairly nonstop. I'm handling a number of different things, but yes, I actually exercise every single morning. Basically the first thing I do when I wake up is I'm either out for a run or in the gym hitting the weights, and I try to do a pretty intense workout for 30 to 45 minutes. And then I do have a sort of zen period of 30 minutes before I actually start my workday. I'll, you know, take my shower, make coffee, sit on and just take a moment to reflect before letting the speed of the day kind of come at you. And I think that really kind of grounds me and centers me and keeps me focused on the top priorities.
Sounds like fairly similar to what I've heard a lot of other people say. I'm always curious about that morning routine because it's not easy doing what we do.
Right.
And we need that energy. But I've seen people go, yeah, I drink 5 cups of coffee a day. I've heard people go, yeah, I smoke weed all day. I've heard people say all sorts of things. But the interesting consistency is exercise and something like a meditation.
Yep, that's very, very critical for me. I find that anytime I'm unable to exercise, whether it's due to injury or sickness or lack of sleep, and I needed to get that extra sleep instead, it's a setback for sure.
I've noticed that I came back to Europe a few days ago and I felt quite sick. I got sick in Colombia and went, ended up going to the hospital because I wasn't sure what was going on. I was in bed for 4 days. So I realized that as I'm traveling long-term, I'm not exercising. I might be walking, but I'm not exercising and I'm gaining weight and I'm eating really good. And by good, I mean unhealthy. And so I came back and I instantly bought a scale and some weights so that I could work out in my room, so that I could just get back in shape. And because I've noticed that when you don't exercise for long periods of time, you just fall apart mentally and physically. And then you gain weight, of course, which, you know, nobody likes to feel that they've gained weight. So if you weren't doing this, is there anything else that you would really want to do?
Well, I will say I am a a very avid traveler as well. And I do have a lifelong goal of wanting to set up my own hostel or, you know, potentially a hotel someday with like a restaurant and a bar and like tour activities and so on and so forth. So it's a completely different world from where I am right now. But someday I would love to do that. Other than that, honestly, I am doing what I love. What I really enjoy is coaching and mentoring both people and companies. And I started my career working at Bain & Company doing strategy consulting there for Fortune 500 companies. And when I was doing that, I spent, you know, a lot of time doing the strategy for one organization, but then I would move to another organization in a different industry and work on strategy for them. And that process really illuminated for me how much I enjoy kind of context shifting and working with companies in different industries and understanding, you know, the commonalities between them. And I've noticed that I do the same thing in my personal life. So one of the reasons I love traveling so much.
Hey, just give me 10 seconds of your time. I really appreciate you listening to the episode so far, and I hope you're loving it. And if you are, I would love to ask you to subscribe to the channel, because what we do is a lot of work. And every week we bring you a new guest and a new story. And what we do requires so much love, so that we can bring you something amazing. And every week we're trying really hard to get better guests that have better stories and improve our ability to tell their stories. So your subscription lets the algorithm know that what we're doing is fantastic. And no commitment, it's free to do. And if you don't like what we're doing later on, you can always unsubscribe. And either way, we would love a like if you don't feel like subscribing at this time. Thank you very much, and we'll take you back to the show now.
And I've been to 137 countries is because of the fact that I can see the parallels between different parts of the world. You know, if you go to part of the developing world in Southeast Asia and outside of the major city, and you see how people are behaving in rural areas, and then you do the exact same thing in South America or in Sub-Saharan Africa, you're going to see, you know, kids playing with sticks and tires in exactly the same way across the world. And just parallels that seem really interesting and fascinating to me. And I find the same kind of thing when I'm advising companies. They might be in completely different stages or in different industries, but I start to see that there's, you know, parallel needs or gaps or lessons that can be applied. And by being one of those people that walks between the different worlds, I can bring my experience from one end, you know, one area to another. And that I've always just really enjoyed. And so, you know, I wouldn't really trade in my job that I have right now for something else, other than, yes, that lifelong goal of someday starting something completely different.
Well, you got me beat. I'm about 50 countries in. most great. Americans.
50 is impressive. And I believe you've spent a lot of time abroad, which is also another way to measure your experience.
Yeah, I left the States in 2008. So it's been 16 years.
Yeah.
And generally when I go to a country, I'm there like 2 to 4 weeks at least, because I want to really get to know them. I don't want to go for a few days. And so I like the immersion part. So that was one of the reasons why I liked being in Colombia. And then Costa Rica is because they're both Spanish speaking countries that are nearby each other, but also different in culture. And so by spending so much time in each of them, I was able to see what do I like, what do I not like. For example, Costa Rica is stupid expensive. It's like 3 or 4 times more expensive than Colombia. Yep. And in Colombia, they speak English is a lot less common. And so I had a better experience in Colombia because I was doing tours every day and the tours were in Spanish. And because I was booking the tours in the middle of the work week, it was usually just me and the tour guide. So I was getting a VIP tour for the price of a group tour.
Yes.
And I would have 2, 3, 4, 5 hours with this guide, and I would just speak Spanish with them. I would learn about the topic, and, you know, it was just a phenomenal cultural immersion immersive experience for Colombia, and then Costa Rica was a little more touristy, a little more commercial, and a lot more English. And so it was a little bit sad for me because I had just experienced this incredible thing. And part of it was my brother came, met me in Costa Rica, and he doesn't speak Spanish. And so everything we did, either I had to speak to the people in Spanish and translate, which was fine. Or we had to do something in English so that he'd understand. And that, I think, kind of dragged it down, but kind of getting off topic here. So I guess two questions off topic from the motivation. Which country would you want this hotel, hostel, restaurant, bar to be in? Because I'm assuming it's not in the States. If I'm wrong, fair. If then, what part of the States? And which country has been your favorite so far? And for me, it's been Colombia. It's one of the top three.
Gotcha. Yeah. My answer for both of those questions would be Thailand. I got married in Thailand. My wife is not from there. We're both from America, but we both love it there and got married there. I also work in Vietnam quite a bit. So between the two, those are my two favorite countries. They're very similar, but also distinctly different. And I think I would enjoy spending a lot of time later in life in that part of the world.
Well, I lived in Vietnam for 4 years. I'm not sure you're aware. Yeah. And Vietnam was definitely a beautiful country. I was unhappy to leave it during COVID. I have not been back since then. Thailand, I've been to like 4 or 5 times. Honestly, Vietnam's better for me than Thailand. As a culture, as a society, I think Vietnam is a lot less touched from like the traveler perspective. So sure. I think Vietnam is more enjoyable for me for a number of those reasons. But I can't blame you for wanting to set up something in Thailand. It is definitely a beautiful country.
Yeah, I would argue that Vietnam has a more homegrown economy and therefore doesn't have as much international tourism as Thailand does. That partly influences my thought. Like Thailand has probably a better market if you were to set up a, you know, tourist location for people to stay. But yeah, it's for me, I love both countries and I agree with you. They're a little bit different from each other. And they have a different vibe. I mean, perhaps the play is to set up a chain and have locations in both countries.
can't stop thinking about business, can you?
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad you're thinking about retirement overseas because I talk to so many people and they're like, America is the best country. And it's like, yeah, but if you haven't been anywhere else, how do you know? One, and two, what makes you think you're going to be able to afford retiring in America? I mean, my aunt's 85 and she retired in Costa Rica 10 years ago with her husband because they couldn't afford to retire in America. And they love Costa Rica. Well, he died about 5 years ago, but she's still there and she loves it.
So, yeah, I mean, the money goes a lot further in these other places and they're beautiful. So,
yeah, people don't realize that when I talk to people in Portugal, they're like, oh, Portugal must be cheap for you, because they look at me and they go, oh, he's an American. I go, yeah, but I was in Asia for, you know, 15 years. And for me, Portugal's really expensive, actually. And they're like, how? I'm like, because I was married to a Vietnamese woman and we were living an upper class lifestyle and I was spending half of the money I'm spending here. And I don't even have my own apartment here. I have to share here. But there I had a 2-bedroom, 2-bathroom with like private security, private pool, private park, private gym for half the price. Right. And it's people don't get it. I'm like, meals are like $1 or $2. And here the meals are like $7, $8, $9, $10, $11, $12.
Right.
You know,
and incredibly delicious.
Yeah. Don't even get me started. I miss Asia and Vietnam. I do think about it. I would actually quite like to go back to Vietnam and visit this year because it's been 3 years actually next month. Yeah. June 10th is 3 years from when I left Asia. Wow. And I think about it all the time. People are like, why don't you move back to Asia? And I'm like, well, because, you know, I invested in like moving to Europe, right? Because I want to have a life here now because it'd be nice to have a family here. I think Europe is the best for like clean air, clean water, clean food, you know, good education. People are multilingual. So it's like really decent spot to like raise a family, especially compared to Asia, which generally has, you know, not as clean environment, unfortunately, but, you know, can still dream, right?
Yep. At least like you're dreaming out of this there place. living abroad and getting that experience. I think it's invaluable and it can translate into other aspects of your life too.
Yeah. I mean, one of the benefits for me of traveling is that now I know people in a lot of different countries, so I can say, hey, let's go here, you know, cause you're right next door. So for example, I've got a good friend who's from Colombia. I met in China a long time ago and he's now based in Bogota. And well, I went to Colombia because I was in Miami and he's in Bogota and he's like, hey, you should come visit. I'm like, all right, cool. I'm going to come. And like, I went. Yeah.
Nice.
And like and last year,
because then you got to see Bogota through his lens, right? And yeah. Not just through your own. And whenever you have a local to show you around, it's amazing.
Exactly. And like he was in Bogota last year and I was like, hey, I was thinking of going to Guatemala. Like I've wanted to go there for 10 years. I tried to go. And at that time, my friend bailed. So I just decided not to go. And he's like, my mom lives in Guatemala City. And I'm like, let's go to Guatemala and let's spend some time there. And he's like, all right, cool. So we went for a month and we took his mom's van and we drove around the country together. He drove because I'm not going to put myself at risk like that because the roads there are awful. And he drove and somehow we didn't die multiple times because the roads are really bad there. But it was an amazing experience to see it because he had lived in Guatemala for like 12 years. So he went to school there. So he introduced me to his friends in one of the cities and we drove around to parts of the country that he'd never had a chance to go to. So, you know, yeah, I love the ability to just go, yeah, let's go travel here. Or oh, I've never been to this country before. Let me do it on my own. So like I went to Colombia and the first 2 weeks I was by myself because he was like, I'll, you know, come to Bogota and we'll spend time together. But like, I'm not meeting you outside of Bogota. I'm busy. I'm, you know, just like we'll meet there. So I got both sides of the experience. So I go back to this over and over and over again. People don't really think about it too much, but they just go, oh, you know, I want to travel, but right. There's always right. That but. And I'm like, there's no buts. You want to go. Like my brother and I tried to travel together and we were in Panama 12 years ago. And finally we were able to travel to Costa Rica together. It's been 12 years. And he's already like, next year, this time we're going to go to Japan. Right. And I'm like, I can't promise that I'll be able to go to Japan because I don't know where I'm going to be tomorrow, but
right.
Like you got my attention, you know, but like, I don't know. You want to go to Japan for 2 weeks? Like, I feel like I need 3 or 4 months at least in Japan. So like, I don't know, maybe I'll just start learning Japanese now and then maybe I'll go when I can and then you meet me for some part of it and then I'll speak Japanese and I'll translate for you then. And he's like, man, go for it. Yeah, it's one of the motivators for me. That's okay, let's go there. One of the motivating factors for me in leaving China was that I was tied to the economy. And I knew that the economy was in flux. This was in 2014, I realized. And I knew that I had to remove myself from an economy, but I didn't know how to do that without literally leaving China. I said, I've traveled at that point. I'd already traveled to like 20 countries or so, but I was always reliant on China. And if I wasn't in China, I couldn't make money. And so I said, I need to figure out a way that I can make money from any country while I'm in any country. So that if any country has a financial problem, I can still make money from another country. And I can go to the countries that have the financial problems so that I can have a better experience because it's cheaper. So like I went to Greece and it was cheap. And, you know, I've been to Malaysia multiple times and it was always cheap because I took advantage of that. Japan is a great example right now of the yen hitting about 160 to a dollar. It's really weak. So now's an amazing time to go. But if I'm sitting there making dollars, or actually my partners are in the UK, so I get to make British pounds now, which is even better than dollars, then I can have an enjoyable experience and not have to worry about that. So for me, that motivator was I don't trust any economy. The only thing that makes me feel safe is that I don't have to trust any economy. Even the British economy can do horrible, but if our clients are outside of, you know, the UK, we can still charge them pounds. So I can be wherever I want. I choose to be in Portugal. I don't need the Portuguese economy. The Portuguese economy could be a dumpster fire falling off a cliff. Doesn't matter to me. that's been one of the motivators for me. And that's how I've continued to look at my life since I left China 7 years ago.
Yeah. So what I'm hearing there is that you're really motivated by a sense of security, and that like sense of security desire caused you to diversify your revenue sources and really focus on building a kind of a business model that is not dependent on the economic fluctuations of any particular country in a very strong way. And then part of that is also driven by this idea, by this motivation concept of loss avoidance, which is something that we all are motivated by. And it's a black hat motivator, because what it does is it triggers responses quickly, but it doesn't necessarily create long lasting motivation. The long lasting motivation that's got you in this situation is autonomy. You want that ability to just be in charge of yourself and be independent. And that is like this more white hat, positive, long lasting motivation that you want. But it, like, what can trigger more immediate decisions is this idea of loss avoidance. And you don't want to be in a situation where you're potentially losing money just because of something that's completely outside of your control, like economic fluctuations. And so those element that's sort of the elements at play in your life decision making there. And I think it's great. I think that you're setting yourself up well to be able to kind of withstand changes in the world and achieve your life goals. And it's, I mean, I think that's something that so often people kind of overlook, is you only live once, right? And so, you know, this whole idea of like, well, I'd like to travel, but, that we were talking about, I mean, to me, the answer is, but who cares? Like, you only live one time. So if you have all these life goals and you're not actually setting yourself up to achieve them or to live them, then the years are just going to go by. And as I've gotten older, they go by faster and faster. And so I think it's really important that people step back and put themselves in positions to kind of enjoy life the way that they want. But for a lot of people, that security is really critical. And it's more important to have that, you know, safe feeling than to get to do all this exploring and everything like that. So kudos to you to kind of figure out the right balance for yourself.
Yeah, I run towards adventure, but because of a concussion 10, 11 years ago in Panama, I seek adventure that I can enjoy without it being too dangerous that it could kill me. I did that already. And to avoid the loss of cognitive function or you know, anything else, health, I avoid those things. It's like I did paragliding. You know, it's kind of dangerous, but also just safe enough that, like, chances of anything bad happening is quite low. Like, I talked to the guy in Colombia who I did it with, and he's like, yeah, I do like 1,000 of these a year. He's never had anyone die. It's probably safe. You know, I did skydiving. And he's like, yeah, I skydive like 50 times a day. Well, this guy's never got hurt. I'm probably safe. So I try to adapt to this, mindset of, and it came from being on planes that have turbulence. Cause I've noticed that planes have endured more turbulence more frequently and more violently in the last few years. And I'm pretty confident it's from climate change, which I don't have the energy to go into here. But what I learned from that was, if the people working on the plane are not freaked out, I shouldn't be freaked out, because they've probably experienced this and probably worse. So I use that as a mechanism to calm myself down and to just try to enjoy the experience, even if it's like anxiety inducing for most people. So I look at these, you know, oh yeah, this skydiving or bungee jumping or these kinds of things. It's like, okay, people are doing it and they're not dying. So I should probably trust them because they're enjoying themselves. So why shouldn't I? And I think we can try to put that into a business model. not a business model. We're not selling people anything, but I think we can put this into some kind of a thing to kind of help wrap up the episode, where it's like, how can we teach people to stop being motivated by fear, or to stop using fear as a motivator for their products or their services, and instead help them and their customers be motivated by something positive so that they can help them more? And I'll give you an example real fast. Slack. Hate them. I hate them so much I tried to build a competitor. I failed, unfortunately, but I tried to build a competitor because their business model was so bad that they motivated people by fear and pain avoidance. Right. Which I hate.
You lose access to your messages.
Exactly. Pay me $5 per user per month, and I will prevent you from feeling the pain of not having access to your messages. And I said, this is an awful business model. I don't know how the hell people are paying them hundreds of millions of dollars a year to avoid pain. There's got to be a better motivator. There has to be a better business model that you can employ that people go, wow, I get to have this feature if I pay? Brilliant. Here's my money. That's what I want, because I think with that, you can have billions of dollars in revenue from clients instead of hundreds of millions. And they were still running at a loss before they IPO'd, which is insane that they got such a high valuation, but that's a different conversation. So based on my question, how can we use motivation in a more positive way?
Yeah. So, you are absolutely hitting on kind of the elements of the framework that we apply to products. And one of the ways that you can make motivation more positive is to focus on the broader purpose and making the product or the intent of the actions that people are taking with regards to the product something that is like bigger than themselves. So an example is Waze, the traffic driving routing application. Their messaging to their user base is all about slaying the monster of traffic together as a community. And it's this idea that together we can actually fight traffic by communicating updates. And so when you are reporting that there's traffic ahead or a police, scanning speed radar, and you're helping your fellow, drivers that are behind you on the road, it's like an altruistic action that you're doing because you're part of a bigger purpose. And I mean, at the end of the day, humans have been motivated for centuries by the concept of being part of something bigger than themselves. And in fact, people have sacrificed their lives for being part of something bigger than themselves and this bigger mission. And that just creates such a strong importance for people. And it's the basis for so many affiliations that people have in their lives. What religion you're a part of, what nation you're a part of, what movement you're a part of. You can look at any political movement, and the people that are there are motivated by like a lot of things. But one of the big things that keeps them very positive and hopeful is the purpose of the mission, of whatever it is. And so whenever you're creating a product, if you can create ways for people to feel like it's more than just a tool for themselves, it's more than just something that they can get something out of, and it's actually like a group and a community thing, that is the big winner. And then there's also the concept of social influence and having relationships with other members in a community. That's what makes things very sticky, because at the end of the day, humans are social beings, and almost all of the users in most products are going to be social. Even introverts are social. They just maybe don't want to be surrounded by humans all the time and need a break to get energy, but they measure their lives relative to other people. So it's really important to make all of your products something that has opportunities for people to feel like they're part of a community and like they have the opportunity to influence and interact with other members of the product or members of the community. So those are kind of the elements that I would bring to make something feel more positive, if that makes sense.